listening to another episode of the Business of Aesthetics podcast series brought to you by our gold sponsors, Laser Optic and Equa Marketing. We also want to thank our silver sponsors, Eilis Works and Pronox. If you would like to network and share your experience with our podcast guests and other aesthetic industry professionals, join our Facebook or LinkedIn communities by searching for Business of Aesthetics. Today we are going to be speaking with one of the finest experts in aesthetics. Our host, Jeffrey Richmond, is an award-winning 20-year veteran of the aesthetics industry, whose passion led him to co-found the Business of Aesthetics community. Over to you, Jeff.
Good morning and welcome to another edition of the Business of Aesthetics podcast. We're excited today to have Tanya Lawson, Dr. Tanya Lawson, who comes to us from Londonderry, New Hampshire, which I just learned about, and maybe she'll tell you about their claims to fame. But Dr. Lawson has a really interesting story coming to us via Canada originally, but starting a practice in the United States some years ago, and I'll let her explain her story. But Tanya, good morning. Thanks for joining us today.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me.
I want to start out, there's a lot of things that I want to ask you about, but I wanted to talk, you're a naturopathic doctor.
And that's right.
So an MD, if for those of you that don't know what an MD is, it's time to crawl out from under your rocks. But I think most people know what MDs are, and most in aesthetic medicine are really at conferences and things like that, starting to meet more and more MDs, because MDs are getting more and more involved in aesthetics. And I think going and then getting more and more involved administratively and legislatively as well. So they're going to more conferences. And I think a lot of us have met them. And I've also noticed lots of allopathic physicians that have adopted naturopathic practices in their practices as part of whole wellness. So I'm really interested. Can you tell us, like, maybe give us a little bit of history, how you got into naturopathic medicine, and then we can kind of talk about the transition after, but maybe if you just share your original story with us.
Sure. So naturopathic doctors, we go to a separate medical school where it really takes a holistic focus on the patient. We learn a lot about nutrition, we learn about supplements, herbal medicine. Being trained in Canada, I was also trained in acupuncture, lifestyle changes, physical medicine. So we use a lot of different modalities besides your traditional pharmaceuticals. Growing up in Canada, you know, I'm from this very small rural area originally, and the healthcare system, being a public system, is very overburdened. You're lucky if you have a family doctor, you go to see your family doctor, you're probably gonna wait at least an hour for that appointment. When you go in, you're gonna maybe have 2 minutes with your doctor, one concern at a time per appointment, and often you're gonna leave with that prescription. My university background, I really focused more on psychology, had a real interest in health psychology, you know, what drives people to be healthy? How can we incorporate and motivate people to be healthy using psychology? And I had never heard, growing up in a small town, I had never heard of a naturopathic doctor. There were no naturopathic doctors practicing anywhere near where I lived. But being in university and kind of being in my undergrad program, I thought, you know, I had an interest in medicine. I come from a family of healthcare providers. And I was looking at various professions, including traditional medicine. And when I learned what naturopathic medicine was, and it incorporated so much more than just prescribing medications, and also included that counseling part, that helping people be healthy, helping the prevent illnesses, I was really drawn to that. So I applied to the program and I got accepted. And I studied in Toronto, you know, did those 4 years, and then you do board exams and are able to practice. When I graduated from naturopathic medicine. You know, I knew I wanted to work for myself. I had no interest in joining a practice, or some people took hospital positions in the US. As soon as I graduated, I actually started renovating my first clinic. I spent that whole summer renovating that clinic and waiting for my license to get issued in the fall. My license was issued October 1st. I opened my practice October 6th.
Wow. Good timing. So you're ready to you're ready to
I had a backup plan in case my license did not arrive on how I was going to launch this, but you know, everything ended up working out, so I didn't need to do that.
So then you're at this point, are you practicing naturopathic medicine and starting to get interested into aesthetics, or when?
Well, not yet. So my first business was a full-scale wellness clinic. I had a vision. I opened it up in a smaller city close to where I was originally from, and I felt like I wanted to do things to augment this public system, right? In Canada, most people don't have to pay when they go to the doctor. It's covered through our public system, through their taxes. So the mentality of, hey, I'm going to go see a doctor and pay for that, that's a little new there at the time. So I thought, well, let's do things that we can, you know, augment and enhance the care people are already receiving. And you know, if they're not getting better from maybe the medications they're on, or they're having side effects, what can we do to help mitigate that? So I opened an integrative healthcare center with chiropractic, massage therapy, acupuncture, naturopathic medicine, and really tried to, offer those wellness services. By my second year in practice, an opportunity came to take over a second location in a neighboring city. So I jumped on that. And then I started building those wellness practices. It was at that point in time when I took on that second location, I started really being interested in skin conditions. I had a lot of patients with acne, rosacea. You know, we were using some of the naturopathic treatments, changing the diet, using supplements. Maybe they had been on medications and really wasn't seeing the results, you know, the immediate results that these patients want, right? They've been on their supplement protocol for 6 weeks, changed their diet for 6 weeks while they still have pimples, or they're still having, you know, the flushing from rosacea. So I started exploring other ways that maybe I could help these patients. So I bought my first IPL device back in, say it was probably late 2007, early 2008. And I said, I'm going to, you know, treat medical skin problems. I'm going to treat these acne patients and these rosacea patients. Well, at the time, we were also using IPL for sunspots, skin rejuvenation, hair removal back then. So when I launched this machine, you know, I launched it to the full scale of its capabilities. And to my surprise, patients were not asking about the acne and rosacea. They were, oh, can you fix this wrinkle? I have this sunspot. You know, what else can you do? And then that kind of spiraled into, okay, well, I don't have anything in my repertoire to treat, you know, crow's feet, or to treat lack of volume. What else can I get? What else can I train in? And I started doing injectable training. And it really just kind of became its separate facility, the medical spa. Still connected to the wellness, but it was almost like two branches of the same business. So that's how I really got into this. I also found the priorities were very different for patients when it came to how they looked. Many patients who told me they couldn't afford to, you know, buy a $20 supplement would be the first patient to pay $1,000 for laser hair removal. So that was also interesting to see what patients prioritized. I still believe truly and fundamentally, and we carry this through in our business model today, it's hard to look your best if you're not healthy. So that's something, you know, my business now in New Hampshire, In Bloom Health and MediSpa, because we still really focus on health. Everyone who, you know, all my staff, they're really, you know, they eat healthy at work, you know, they live, they really live the talk. And I think our patients can see that, because when they come into our office, you know, people look, we look fresh faced, we look natural. It's really this natural beauty that people in New Hampshire gravitate to, right? We're a very healthy state. We're an outdoorsy state. We've got mountain beaches. And I always joke that I probably wouldn't do very well in LA. My patients want to look very natural and inside and outside. So that's really my business model now.
It's neat. The blend of naturopathy and wellness, it seems, even if we're looking our best, if we're not feeling our best, then when we look in the mirror, we don't see our best.
Yeah. So
that feeling can, do you find that more patients, I'll ask you the question, which is, do you find more patients are coming to you for aesthetic concerns and then trying wellness? Or do you feel like people are coming for wellness and then trying aesthetics? Like, what's the draw? And then is it easier to convert one way or another to get them to embrace the entire practice?
So our focus was on wellness. Initially, even in New Hampshire, as I was getting established, as I was trying to purchase equipment and building that aesthetic side of the practice. But I think when people come in for wellness and start feeling better, then they look in the mirror and say, hey, you know, I want to look as good as I feel. What can you do? And then we've already built a trust and rapport. So it's very easy for them to transition into the aesthetic realm. And also, so, you know, there are so many people doing aesthetics, but when they already know and trust the provider, it's easy for them to stay in the practice and just get it done here. But on the flip side, we definitely have patients who come in, you know, they're coming in for injectable treatment, laser, and then they didn't realize, oh, we do all these other things, and they aren't feeling good. They're tired. They have weight that, you know, despite best efforts, diet, exercise, it's not coming off. So we do have those patients transition into the wellness program. So it's nice. It's nice to have both, and it's nice to have both in our repertoire here, because I think we can really help people feel their best, whatever that means to that patient. So it can be very personalized.
Yeah, it seems there's longevity there. There's a relationship there that goes beyond a brown spot, right? So it's really building that relationship with you.
And I think, you know, the strength of naturopathic doctors is that patient-centered care. Right from your first year in medical school, we're taught that the patient is not a diagnosis. It's a person with a condition and symptoms, and it's okay to be personally connected to your patients. It's okay to care about your patients. And I think that translates really well, even for some of these aesthetic services.
So did you start the aesthetic, you started doing aesthetics still while you were in Canada?
Yes. So this, you know, scope has changed a little bit in where I'm from in Ontario, which is unfortunate because I think they've gone backwards in some of the areas in aesthetics in Ontario. But at the time when I was practicing, we were able to, you know, utilize laser, light therapy, fillers. I did have someone in a medical director and a nurse to do my Botox.
But that first IPL was in Canada, though.
Yeah, it was.
Okay.
Yeah, and we had a full-scale medical, I had a full-scale medical spa in Canada, and, you know, I had the two locations, also had the wellness clinic, and really, you know, by my fifth year of being in business there, I was really starting to see the fruits of my labor pay off. Debts were getting paid down, practice schedules were full, my providers were busy, had a great team. And I have this memory from working there. This one night, it was in the winter, it was before Christmas. I got in my car to drive home after work. It was dark out. And I remember looking in my rear view mirror in my car back at my clinic. And I could see my light lit up, my sign lit up, and my chandeliers like having a nice glow in the waiting room. And inside, I just felt like I've made it, like this is it, like I'm doing what I love, like this is my business, it was one of the best feelings. I was just so proud and happy because it took a lot to get to that point. most entrepreneurs know, like, it's ups and downs. It's a lot of hard work. It's pounding the pavement. It's financial stress. It's sleepless nights. But then suddenly, one spring day in 2011, my husband told me he wanted a divorce. And this single event actually changed the trajectory of my entire life. At 31, I was going to be a single mother. I had to sell my home. I had to sell part of my business and restructure. And I was completely devastated. I some days don't, looking back, don't even know how I found the strength in me to carry on. It took everything I had. But I really believe everything happens for a reason. And I started, after this event to rebuild my life. I was still in Ontario, Canada at the time. I bought a little house to raise my daughter in. I continued to work in my downsized business, which was the medical spa wellness clinic still. So I'm still doing what I love. And I started to date. And I ended up meeting a wonderful man. And we got married. But there was a catch. He was American and I was Canadian. So what were we going to do? And this is what ultimately ended with me leaving Canada and leaving my business and starting over in the United States. So I came to New Hampshire in 2015 and I was ready to start over. I mean, I felt like, here we go. I've done this before. I'm going to rebuild this wellness clinic and medical spa that I loved. And I felt like it's going to be easier this time because I've already done it. I've already started something from scratch and it was successful. So I'm going to just go out and do this again. But it was not easy. It was not easy. I came to a community and an area where I knew no one. My husband knew no one. We are not from New Hampshire. He's a Michigan native. All of his family lives in Atlanta, Georgia. All of my family and friends live in Canada. So we did not know a soul. I had very limited resources. My divorce had been financially difficult. I went to the bank and, try to get some sort of financing or credit card. And I was told that because I was Canadian, my credit score was basically nothing in the US. And they offered me a $500 credit card. And I remember saying to the banker, I said, but I'm a doctor. And he said, well, come back in 6 months and we can maybe give you an increase. And I laugh about it now, but at the time that was a bitter pill to swallow, coming from this big established practice in Canada and then to learn in the US that, I was pretty much starting with nothing. But in the interim, I took a temporary job that was less than ideal, but I used that time to really kind of, okay, I'm gonna take this job, but I am gonna focus on how I wanna plan this future business, what I'm gonna create. And then when I was first finally able to start my own practice, I rented a single room, I had one assistant, and over time it grew. And now this spring, I'm expanding into 4,000 square foot facility. We have 8 staff members and I'm a mother of 3. And I totally understand that running a successful business and trying to find balance is hard. And it's been a lot of determination and sacrifice to get here.
I'm curious when you relaunched your career, when you restarted, did you buy an IPO again, first of all?
I do have an IPO.
I'm just wondering what you started with equipment-wise, like what your first piece was, because your first piece in Canada was IPO, which I think is really common for like 80, yeah. 85% of practices. I'm just curious if you started again with IPO and
That's so funny you should say. So that first IPL I had in Canada, even though it was my first IPL, I learned very quickly it probably wasn't, the best IPL. So I did upgrade it, within 6 months of that purchase. But when I started with a YAG and an IPL.
Okay, yeah. So you did a little bit more, you added to your services a little bit. Because IPL, at the end of the day, it's an awfully big menu. And yeah. I think, especially within naturopathy, where we think there's going to be a lot of crossover with acne, whether there is or not, but we assume there will be, then IPL really makes sense for that, or LED, but I mean, you're kind of limited there. So you start with these couple of devices. You already know how to be an injectable trainer or an injectable provider as well. So you start offering those services. What about the naturopathic side? Like, I'm curious how you, well, we talked about scope of practice. So your scope actually improved because in the United States, NDs have a larger scope of practice. Like here in Oregon, NDs are allowed to do minor surgery above the muscle. So even liposuction is in the wheelhouse. I don't know a lot of NDs that do that, but you know, within the scope. But so here your scope opens up, but in the same token, I'm guessing your focus narrowed down a little bit because you have the experience of figuring out things you love, that you're good at, that you like doing every day. So can you talk about how you made those choices?
Yeah. So, you're right. It was so amazing coming to a state where I could actually practice in a way that was very different from my Ontario practice. You know, even in Ontario, I wasn't even allowed to prescribe an antiviral pre-treatment if someone was prone to cold sores to get their IPL. I'd have to send them back to their primary to get the prescription, and then they could come in for treatment. So just even having that flexibility and that, I think it gave me more confidence to know, okay, if a complication occurs or I need to do something for the patient, I am able to do that on my own. I don't have to, you know, send them out and then get them to come back, because that's now in my scope. Even in New Hampshire, I spearheaded the increase of scope for aesthetic providers in naturopathic medicine. In New Hampshire, there's not very many naturopathic doctors, and very few of us practice aesthetics. Right now, there's two of us in the state practicing aesthetic medicine. So when I arrived in New Hampshire, there were some aesthetic procedures we could do on our formulary in terms of medication, and there were others we could not. So in my time here, we were able to get Botox added to our formulary, fillers, Sculptra, hyaluronic acid, etc. So I'm really proud of that, because I feel like, in a way, being the small profession, we were able to really work with our board to show them and justify to them why this should be in our scope and that we are trained and able to do it.
And so, and you formed an association in that process as well, right? With other like-minded.
Yeah, so actually the association is a newer, so in New Hampshire, myself and actually 18 other providers band it together to create a state association for medical aesthetics. So this is called Aesthetic Medical Providers of New Hampshire. People can find us online at ampnh.com. But this actually came out of a bigger issue that's going on in the field in New Hampshire. And I'm not sure if it's going on in other states as well, but the Board of Pharmacy last year has the right to inspect all medical practices in the state, targeted med spas. And during these inspections, providers were told that we could not use Botox as a multi-use vial, even when reconstituted with bacteriostatic saline. We, as providers, feel that reconstituting with bacteriostatic saline, this vial has been shown in the literature to be safe. This is the standard of care in aesthetic medicine. This is what's being taught across the board in training facilities. And we felt like we needed to band together to really educate, not just the Board of Pharmacy, but our medical boards in this regard. So we were able to, get these violations, if you will, put on hold with the Board of Pharmacy. But unfortunately, what transpired a few months later was a med spa bill that would regulate medical spas more than any other medical practice in the state. It would put us through additional inspections, additional fees. There were things in the bill that just did not make sense from a business or patient care side. So we felt as an organization that we needed to fight this bill with everything we had, because anyone in New Hampshire who's a medical director for a med spa is a medical doctor, nurse practitioner, naturopathic doctor. And surgical centers in New Hampshire aren't even subject to the inspections that and the restrictions that we would have been subject to. So we worked really hard to get this bill, to keep this bill from passing this session in legislature, and we were successful. However, we continue to monitor what's going on from a legal standpoint and from a political standpoint in the state. I think, you know, everyone in this group, and I think all reputable medical aesthetic providers, we want patient safety. We want, you know, guidelines that make sense. But this bill did not fit that. So we're really hoping that if anything transpires even in the future, that we can act as a resource and we can act as consultants to put in regulations that make sense for the patient, make sense for the industry, and make sense for the medical boards.
Yeah, I think what you're seeing there is paralleled throughout the country with having loose to no legislation regarding aesthetics. So it was a little bit of the wild, wild west. And then the response to that was, let's regulate anything and everything to the point that sometimes it doesn't make sense. Like I know in Oregon and Washington, they've looked at, you know, depths of different treatments, but some are ablative, some are non-ablative. So it you know, it matters. Or, you know, you can use a microneedle, but you can only go this depth. And if you go deeper, yeah, then it's considered a different, and just things that are really arbitrary in terms of patient safety and whatnot. So they're limiting to what kind of treatments you can do, but they really don't impact patient safety.
No. And, you know, I was part of the lobbyist committee. I serve as co-president of the association. And it was so eye-opening for me to go to some of these events and meet senators, meet House representatives that didn't even know what a medi spa was. They're like, is it a salon? Like, what is it? You know, and doing that education piece to let them know these are medical practices. You know, this is, I approach an aesthetic patient the same way I would if it was someone coming into a family practice. We're doing our assessment, we're doing a health history, we're documenting, we're photo documenting. And I think that was really eye-opening for them. So I'm really excited to continue to do this education piece because it's really needed here.
Yeah, that's neat. I wanted to focus back on the practice for a few minutes. On the services that you offer, so you have what I would call traditional medi spa services. I think skincare is probably a little more integrated into the practice through the wellness and general health piece. But how do you cross market services to patients? So if they come in for A and then they realize that you do B, how do you educate them that you do B and C and D? Like, what are the, how do you communicate that with your patients, or how do you share with them the entirety of what's offered in InBloom?
Yeah, I think that's always a challenge because it can get overwhelming really fast when you offer so many different things. I'm fortunate that I've really tried to brand my practice in a very specific way, so that I'm attracting a very specific client. You know, we're more of a boutique style practice. So when patients come in, they're often coming in with their concerns and then rely on us to tell them what would best help those concerns. And it's not to say we don't get someone coming in, I want Botox, that's all I want. And, you know, but I would say a lot of our really good patients, they're coming in more for that comprehensive look. And I think even from the aesthetic side, because we really get to know our patients, and we really, you know, we want to know what's going on in their lives. A lot of them will say things like, oh, these hot, like, I wish I like didn't have these hot flashes. And it's like, well, we have a hormone balancing program. Did you know about that? So it's a lot of just talking with patients. Of course, we have our social media, we have our website, things like that. But I think just really getting to know the patients and talking with them and suggesting things, so that they are educated that those services are available to them should they need them, is important.
The you mentioned the intake, you know, that patient's first meeting. So are you always trying to do a comprehensive consult? Is that your goal, or do you consult for the specific thing that the patient wants?
So I'd probably say our intake is more comprehensive maybe than your standard medical spa. Cause I'm asking people, do you drink water? How's your caffeine? And, you know, things like that. What's your diet like? In conjunction with their skin concerns or their aesthetic concerns. But I would tell you, I'm not doing a full naturopathic wellness intake on patients who are coming in for aesthetics. It's more abbreviated.
Yeah.
Because there's just not enough time.
Yeah. And I think naturopaths feel that way. And that, I mean, and it's one of the reasons, unfortunately, I think they're grossly underpaid, is they can only charge for a consult what people will pay, which is maybe a few $100. And consults can take hours to really do them right. So that it's a challenge.
It's hard to scale. It's really hard to scale as an ND when you're just trading, you know, time for money, and you only have, you know, one person. And then there's also the behind the scenes work that's primarily unpaid that patients don't really understand. Like when we have to do prior authorizations for insurance, we have to review all the labs and make sure, you know, those are followed up appropriately. Patients might be messaging through an electronic medical record all day. This is kind of, these are time sucks that don't have compensation associated with it, especially in an insurance-based model. But even in a non-insure, I've never taken insurance directly from my services. We take HSA, FSA, but even in that model, still if like medication prior auths where, you know, they need their medication from their pharmacy or you know, the lab review, the messaging. So we've changed our model in our practice to be a little bit different. So we have a wellness program, which is designed to be a 5-visit program for a set fee. And it kind of incorporates all of that additional time that would be needed. So maybe we're seeing less patients, but those patients are paying a little more of a premium to get that level of service. Time is valuable. And I think, you know, a lot of patients really, especially in New Hampshire, there's a real lack in that kind of holistic care. So there is value associated with it. A lot of patients who come and see me have already been to 5 or 6 different providers, and they're looking for something different. Also, a membership model is something else that providers can do where, you know, again, maybe you have less patients, but you're, you know, getting paid a monthly fee that would cover all of those services.
Can you share the details of that? I think a lot of people are interested in a membership program.
Sure. So there's different ways to do a membership program. So I'm not primary care. I don't focus on primary care. So there are direct primary care models that I can't speak to because that's just not something I have experience with. But in terms of, we do a wellness membership model. So our wellness membership model, it's, we charge $249 a month, and it includes 4 visits a year. It includes messaging on the portal. It includes discounts on supplements. And then we do offer some discounts on medical aesthetic services to try to encourage the crossover. And then it involves discounted labs.
And is anyone a member for the aesthetic side?
Yes. So we also have an aesthetic membership program. So that is, again, a set fee. It includes a service per month, and they can choose from having an IPL, a skin wave facial, a regular facial appeal, laser genesis. And then we offer a product discount, discounts on some of the crossover to like weight management and whatnot.
Awesome.
Dr. Lawson, I think that's the way to go. I see a lot of clinics doing that, and I think that's really smart. I think it's building, you know, loyalty with your patients. And I think the more often they can come in and see you and see your clinic, they're going to use other services as well.
Do you, Dr. Lawson, I was going to say, I just want to thank you for your time in the business of aesthetics community. Thanks you for sharing and, you know, being so open with us about your practice. It's been interesting to learn and think through and share your thought process, being able to refocus your practice and really build this new entity that you love. And it's easy to see how happy you are having built this. So I hope as you're driving away later tonight and you look through your rearview mirror that you feel the way that you did that first time. But I thought it was a remarkable comment that a lot of us forget. We're working really hard. It doesn't feel like it every day, but sometimes we just need to take that, even that few seconds, to look in the rearview mirror and feel proud of ourselves about what we've accomplished. And business owners don't have someone to come pat them on the back and say, great job, you've worked really hard. You know, why don't you take some time off? Why don't you go do something for yourself? Like, those are things that we do for our employees, but there's no one there to do it for you. So to be able to do it for yourself, I just want to leave you with the last word. If you have anything you want to share, any tip, anything you tell a young, that you would tell a younger physician or an entrepreneur about, you know, your journey or starting this, any last words of advice?
Oh, yeah. So many, but, you know, you've got to love what you do, right? If you haven't watched Steve Jobs' commencement speech from Stanford, have you watched that?
Yeah.
So right. He says the only way to do great work is to love what you do. And if you haven't found it, keep looking. Don't settle. Life's too short.
That's awesome. Dr. Lawson, if other members of our community want to get in touch with it, I know you're active on our Facebook group. You may be in our LinkedIn group as well. Social media, contact information, how could our community reach out to you if they want to continue a conversation?
Yeah, absolutely. And I am happy to talk to anyone wanting to get in the business or just, you know, I think having community is so important. And I mentor new providers.
You know, if they're in New Hampshire, you want them. Because you want them to join that.
Yes, if they're in New Hampshire, you definitely need to be part of our amazing group. But they can find me on social at InBloom Health, NH. And then you'll see my name pop up in Business of Aesthetics as well.
Awesome. On behalf of the Business of Aesthetics community, we thank you so much. If you love this podcast, please share it. If you have other physicians that you want to ask specific questions to or think would be great guests, colleagues that you'd love to hear from, please go to businessofaesthetics.org and submit their information. Good afternoon to you all.
Thank you for joining us this week on the Business of Aesthetic podcast series brought to you by our gold sponsors, Laser Optech and Equa Marketing. Our silver sponsors, Eilease Works and Pronox. Would you like to join our growing group of aesthetic industry experts and get featured on the Business of Aesthetics podcast? Or do you know someone who would love to share their strategies for growth in the aesthetics business, providing quality patient care or their clinical expertise? Head on over to www.businessofaesthetics.org/podcast-show and apply to be featured as a guest on the show. Remember to subscribe to this podcast on iTunes, Google Play, Amazon Music, or wherever you listen. If you would like to engage with today's or any of our past speakers, join our Facebook group or LinkedIn group by searching for Business of Aesthetics. Thank you and have a great day.